Holocaust Remembrance Day continues to be in our annual calendar to bring those lessons learned into the context of the world today. A world where certain political and other actors thrive on misinformation and populist arguments, spreading messages and misconceptions driven by hatred and intolerance. We therefore welcome you to this event that honors Holocaust victims and survivors, an event to share messages of peace that remain so essential in countering strategies of exclusion. For the opening of the event, let's please welcome Dr. Ruth Farrugia, Director General of the President's Foundation.
It's with great pleasure that we thank you for accepting our invitation to join us for this event to mark Holocaust Remembrance Day. Since its inception, the President's Foundation for the Wellbeing of Society has commemorated this day as part of its remit to combat prejudice and hatred by fostering peace and well-being. We ask ourselves why it's still important to highlight the traumatic experiences endured by Holocaust survivors and the tragic end of the millions who perished at the death camps during the Second World War. And to this we answer that without acknowledging history, we run the very real risk of repeating the atrocities that shame us and our humanity. Given our ongoing work with children and our emphasis on child participation at national and European levels, we decided to focus mainly on the experience of a child in transmitting this message to children and young people. So we invited the curators of the Anne Frank Museum to tell us about the house and to bring it to life for people who haven't yet visited. We interviewed Anne Frank's stepsister, Eva Schloss, and you will have the opportunity to watch and listen to her assessment of both past and current events. We also invited the Yad Vashem World Holocaust Center from Jerusalem to visit Malta and share some Holocaust education among many secondary and post-secondary schools. Birte will tell us more about this soon. We hope that these items and the distinguished panel who have agreed to speak will help us to recall the momentous watershed in history which has impacted on our understanding of human rights and our individual responsibility to stand up for what is right, not just for ourselves, but for all members of society. Will you now please join me in welcoming Her Excellency, Mar Louise Colero Preca, President of Malta, to make her address. Thank you.
Thank you, Ruth, not just for introducing me, but also for being catalyst to bring about this very important event and many other events that the President's Foundation for the Wellbeing of Society is continuously conducting. I would also like to acknowledge the contributions of our young people from the Children's Council within the President's Foundation for the Wellbeing of Society. Our children will be taking center stage later on this evening to read from Anne Frank's diary, both from the English and Maltese translations. The interest that has been expressed by our children and the young people at every Holocaust remembrance over the last few years gives me much hope. These remembrances should always be a statement in favor of peace and inclusion. These remembrances must be an opportunity to remember the pain and suffering of the millions of people who were treated in the most inhumane of ways in the past. These remembrances must be a reaffirmation of our willingness to continuously work for peace. This is essential because we know that human memory is short and quite selective. Unfortunately, the world is still experiencing the erosion of human rights, the resurgence of ideologies of division, the scourge of conflicts and wars, the displacement of so many families and the death of so many millions across the globe. We often talk about the power of change, yet I wonder whether humanity has been truly changed by the legacy of our past. For this reason, the commemoration of the Holocaust cannot be merely a one-off event. The commemoration of the Holocaust must create in us the urgent willingness for effective action in favor of peace. Our acknowledgement of the suffering which the Holocaust represents must be translated into a firm commitment to promote and to prioritize the dignity and the well-being of all people who are experiencing precarity, vulnerability, discrimination, and abuse. Education is key to achieve a future that is free of such injustices. By educating new generations of children, young people, and educators, we can better the chances for our future generations to work for peace and to live in a peaceful and respectful world where each and every one of us is treated as a valuable collaborator. I would therefore like to encourage our authorities to take up peace studies as an integral part of our educational curriculum. It is in this way that we can ensure that a culture of peace can be built for our generation and for future generations. The importance of education is also echoed by the United Nations and its Holocaust outreach program this year. The chosen theme entitled Holocaust Remembrance and Education, Our Shared Responsibility, sums up the message we want to convey, which is that Holocaust education is our shared responsibility in our commitment to build peace. This theme also highlights the universal dimension of the Holocaust so that future generations will firmly reject all forms of racism and violence. I am convinced that the Holocaust has much to teach us about the danger of extremism and the prevention of violent discrimination in today's world. We should be aware of the dangers of populist discourse which is returning in our world today. Such discourse thrives on fear and scaremongering with devastating consequences for countless people. I truly believe that we need to work together as a society to increase awareness about the danger of such discourse. All people of goodwill must stand together to counter the efforts of spreading deliberate misinformation that fuels extremism, that encourages hatred, and which incites violence. This Remembrance Day is an opportunity to reflect on how we can come together to share a more powerful message of peace and inclusion. It is also an opportunity to pay our respects to the millions who were murdered during the Holocaust, including Jews, members of minority groups, LGBTIQ people, persons with disabilities, political activists, and many more. The tragedies of the Holocaust must remind us of everyone's rights to live freely from discrimination. These rights must be defended at all costs, and we all have a responsibility to ensure that these rights are upheld for everyone and everywhere. Each and every one of us and the international community at large has the responsibility to champion the rights of persecuted people so as to ensure that the due respect to minorities and vulnerable groups is given in our daily lives. We must all be aware that millions of people across the globe face daily threats. Many are fleeing wars and persecution and are the targets of inhumane actions based on hatred and intolerance. But there are also people around us in the communities where we live that similarly feel mistreated, unwelcome, and excluded. Let us keep in mind also all those people around us who suffer bullying, domestic violence, prejudice, and other forms of abuse. This is also violence and has no place in a culture of peace. Therefore, we must act on the lessons learned and remind ourselves of our shared obligation to ensure everyone's right to live free from discrimination with equal protection under the law. For this reason, I believe that we must do more to promote the concept of dignity and respect in our lives. It is a fundamental component of all the work we do as people of goodwill to secure peace, solidarity, and well-being in our communities and our nations. The reality of human dignity rests at the heart of universal human rights. Human dignity transcends across the barriers of socioeconomic status, ethnicity, gender, sexual orientation, and religion. When we fail to acknowledge, to respect, and to celebrate the dignity of others, we are the ones who lose our dignity. Faced with increasing global uncertainty, we must respond with determined action, with powerful conviction, with courage and strength. I would like to encourage everyone to become tireless champions for the dignity of all people, whoever they are and wherever they are in the world. It is in this way that we will be building peace and well-being for the benefit of both our present and future generations. Thank you.
Let us please now welcome Dr. Dienke Hondius. Dr. Dienke Hondius is an assistant professor of history and a staff member at the Anne Frank House in Amsterdam.
I would like to introduce to you Eva Schloss. As Alessandro mentioned, Jan-Erik and I have met her for the first time in 1985, and then she was very hesitant in coming forward to speak about her experiences as a survivor of Auschwitz. Otto Frank, her second father, had always done the speaking. You were there. You were in Auschwitz. You were liberated in Auschwitz, and so you can tell us what happened. Now it seems normal that we would engage and contact Holocaust survivors, but in 1985 it was not so normal yet. So it took a while for the voices of survivors to be heard and to be addressed and to be shared. And in the last 30, 35 years, we have seen that the voices of survivors have become very, very important. So we are very happy that, of course, many survivors have died now, but especially the hidden children, many of them are still with us. So there are still many, many that we can speak to and that we can invite and get into contact with. So in that respect, I see that there's still a long way to go and a lot of work that we can do. Otto Frank has been very active in the organization of the Anne Frank House as a museum. After it opened, he would always come to the museum and he spoke to many people, and it was his role as father of Anne Frank, father of Margot Frank, the only survivor of his family. A father in mourning. People tell us that he was always crying, that he was very, very sad, and his personal effect has been tremendous in building this memory. And the second effect of Otto Frank is that he wanted to connect history and present day activities. So if you look online on YouTube at small film clips of Otto Frank, you will see that he always connects the present and the past. That is really what he taught us to do. So at the Anne Frank House, that is also what we try to do. He wanted to work against anti-Semitism, of course, but against all forms of discrimination. So that connection is really Otto Frank's message, and that is what we are doing. He moved to Switzerland, where he still had family, in 1953 when he remarried. His wife, Anne Frank's mother, was killed in Auschwitz, and so Otto Frank was alone. But on the way back from Auschwitz via Odessa and Marseille and back to Amsterdam, he met Eva and her mother. Eva has told me that she was, of course, very sad, but she was also very angry after the war. You can imagine that. After everything that happened. And I think we have not really acknowledged the anger of survivors. We see survivors maybe as pitiful, but you can also imagine that they must have been very, very angry about what happened to them. And that was difficult to come to terms with. So after that, Eva didn't know what to do with herself until she became active as a photographer and as a student again, and she moved to London. And especially after 1985-86, she has become very, very active as a survivor, as an eyewitness of Auschwitz and of the whole Second World War. So we could not have predicted how active she has become. And also today she is in Geneva, I think, speaking for the UN. So let's listen to Eva Schloss. Thank you.
Otto Frank, who became, at that time he was just a good house friend, he came a lot, and he, who had lost everything really, had no hatred. And he was actually a proud German. He said, that was terrible, he admitted that, of course, but he said, I'm German myself, and I love their culture, and I love their poetry, and their music, and their whole way of thinking. And you know, you put a smile on your face, go out in the world, and you will see it's not so bad. Well, for Otto, Anne and her diary was really his whole life. That was the most important thing, to spread the message. Not so much the diary as such, but the message he wrote. Because she was only 14, really, when she had those humanitarian ideas about how the world should be as well. You know, there were 1.5 million Jewish children murdered, and she becomes a symbol of all those children.
The next item on the program is a panel discussion. I now invite our guest panel speakers to take a seat at the front. Please welcome Her Excellency Mrs. Gudrun Straga, Ambassador of the Federal Republic of Germany. His Excellency Mr. Johannes Niesen, Ambassador of the Kingdom of the Netherlands. Dr. Birte Huera from the Yad Vashem School for Holocaust Studies. Ms. Hadar Halevi. And Dr. Dinke Hundius from the Anne Frank House.
Ambassador Straga, we could begin with you. I'd like to ask, in what ways do you think the memory of the Holocaust is still an important part of contemporary discussions and contemporary life in Germany? Maybe you can share your thoughts about that.
It has not been easy to have a remembrance culture. In the beginning, the Germans didn't really want to hear about it. They wanted to rebuild their country. They wanted to look forward and not so much to the past. Only in the 60s of the last century, end of the 60s, with the student rebellion, and then some intellectuals came up and really created a remembrance culture. And people were thinking about what had happened. But of course, it's not really easy to tell people, you know, to make people aware what has happened. It's a challenge to face the fact that 60 million people were killed in the Second World War and 6 million Jews were murdered, and this by an industrial machinery of destruction, merciless, relentless in its perfection. And people had to realize that we cannot escape the fact that while anti-Semitism itself was not invented in Germany, but Holocaust certainly was. So it's difficult that remembrance should perpetuate a guilt complex. Young people would not be receptive to this. But still, we must keep an awareness and a responsibility alive. And this has happened, for example, by memorializing the concentration camps, which are in Germany, and there are many. And nowadays, the Holocaust is part of the curricula in the schools, and the teachers with their children drive or go to visit those memorials, be it Buchenwald, be it Sachsenhausen, be it Dachau, but there are different memorial sites in Berlin as well. For example, the House of the Wannsee Conference, where actually the murder of the Jews has been decided, and that's an extremely impressive memorial. So remembrance is going on, and we have our president, Mr. Roman Herzog, already in 1996 has decided that the Holocaust Remembrance Day, which is the 27th of January, should be at that day a ceremony should be held in the German Bundestag, in the German parliament, and since then the Bundestag invites a survivor or other significant guest to speak before the plenary. This year it will be Miss Anita Lasker-Walfisch. She's 92 years old and she's a British-German cellist, and she's a surviving member of the Women's Orchestra in Auschwitz.
Her Excellency spoke about populism and ideologies of division, which seem to be taking root again across Europe and in other parts of the world. In what ways do you think the memory of the Holocaust can help ease us away from such a path?
Thank you for that question. And it's a very good question, very topical. Let me try to address it from this way. I think in the Netherlands, there's a very strong awareness of everything that happened. Anne Frank House in Amsterdam is a very prominent place of remembrance, which I think is very well known and across the world. But it's increasingly the feeling in our culture, in our society, is in our population, is that of course we it's not something you should talk. You should approach as victims and perpetrators, but it's universal values that are at stake. So you have to use remembrance and to use these places, and also the places Gudrun just talked about in Germany, but across Europe and the world, to try to really to get young people to know about these universal values that are at stake, and to learn the collective lessons of these terrible events. So I think that more and more together we are able to do that. Of course, I understand the point you're making about society, and I think in the end of the interview, of the beautiful interview Alessandra had with Eva Schloss, she talked about these issues as well, topical developments in society across the world that give you the feeling, haven't we learned any lesson at all? Sometimes that's what they make you think. And definitely that is very relevant in our society as well, and across Europe. There are tendencies, there are developments that make you wonder whether any lesson has been learned from history. But then again, to answer very concretely your question, I'm myself an historian. I'm very convinced that the lessons of history need to be repeated and need to be shared with people, and especially with young people, over and over again. I think that's the only way to arrive at a point where together, collectively, we do learn the lessons of history. So I'm convinced that this serves the cause, and that it's important to remember and to talk with one another about these experiences, and to try to draw the lessons from it.
My first project at the Anne Frank House many years ago was to make a traveling exhibition where we used the history of Anne Frank's family as an example of what could happen to one family in Germany, then connected with the history of Nazi Germany in the Netherlands, with the occupation of the Netherlands and the deportation. We spoke about the collaboration as well as resistance. It is easy to speak only about resistance. Everyone likes resistance history. But collaboration is a painful episode in Dutch history, and we felt that we also have to address that. To show people that there's always a choice. There are always options. And I think that is one of the most important things that we want to bring across with Holocaust education, to recognize your choices in life, to recognize your opportunities. And Miep Gies, for example, who was one of the helpers of the Frank family, she did the shopping. She had to be asked by Otto, she had to have permission from her husband in order to become active as a helper. And that we know from the history of the Holocaust. Perhaps a lady from Yad Vashem will tell more about that. Most people who helped Jews in hiding had to be asked. Very few people helped spontaneously. So I think one of the important messages is that everyone has a possibility to do something, but you have to have a kind of self-confidence that you are able to do something in every layer of society. Mipris always said, I am not a hero. You have to see what you can do in your own surroundings. You don't have to be a sort of superman or superwoman in order to help another person. So to recognize that opportunity, I think, is quite important. I'm at the moment very inspired directly because your question was about populism as well, and you hear from Eva Schloss that she's very active against this, right? She's not shy to speak her mind about these issues. We had in Amsterdam yesterday a professor Deborah Lipstadt from Atlanta University. She has written about Holocaust denial. And a beautiful film appeared called Denial about the process, the trial she was in against David Irving, a Holocaust denier from London. And she spoke about different forms of denial, and she said, well, you will not come across a lot of people who completely deny the Holocaust happened. There are more subtle forms, she said. She calls it soft denial. And that is what we are up against. And she made comparisons with what she called the assault on democratic institutions today. And she spoke particularly about the United States, but she said also in Europe we see that things are being undermined and assaulted, the free press, legal institutions, democracy is under fire, and we have to see the danger of that. And I feel very strongly that that was very impressive, her speech for Holocaust Memorial Day in Amsterdam yesterday.
I wonder whether there might be another question there, talking about democratic ideals. You spoke eloquently about the need to honor the anger of survivors. Perhaps I have a question for you about that, and maybe Britta could also answer that. In what ways is that a call for justice? And why is it important to accept that there is anger related to these questions? And how is that a move towards some form of justice for this great injustice?
Well, I think anger is one of the most difficult things, right? When is there ever room for anger in family lives or in our lives today? We tend to suppress anger all the time. But you hear from Eva that she hated everyone, and she had to somehow find a possibility out of that. So I think it is important to also understand the emotional history of the Holocaust and the intergenerationals, from how it works to the children and the grandchildren, and how insidious that is. Anger is fine if it leads to action, right? If it leads to shame is fine if it leads to responsibility. So it is what you do with the feelings but to suppress it all is not good. I know many Holocaust survivors and their children, and they all tell me that it takes a long time to come to terms and to find a way out of these difficult emotions.
About the Eva Schloss speaking about her anger, to be honest, I found this very refreshing, because I sometimes have the feeling that we, as a second, third, or fourth generation, have a certain attitude and a certain expectations what we think a survivor should be like, should talk like, or should look like. You know, we think we have to be, if we listen to a survivor, we have to be sad, we have to cry. If we don't cry, then something was not right. No, I think this is where we learned something from. And this is something we just have to respect.
And in a very powerful way, it's about respecting the dignity of the individual. Everybody has, at last year's commemoration, we heard from four different people, and we had four different ways of understanding the experience. How does an organization like Yad Vashem take those specific narratives and create a way to transmit the story to an audience?
Let us remember the Nazi perpetrators did not only try to kill each and every single Jew they could get a hold on. Furthermore, they tried to erase the memory that there ever was Jewish life in Europe. So the Jewish perspective, the perspective of the Jewish victims on the Shoah, on the Holocaust, is a perspective that we should reconstruct. And instead of speaking about them, we should have the survivors speak for themselves. And not only the survivors, we also have testimonies, diaries, letters, photographs of people who did not survive, like in the case of Anne Frank. So, and the more time passes by, the less people are left that we can ask. So, but their testimonies are still there. So we have to think about what are we doing in a world without Holocaust survivors? And even more urgent is the question, how do we pass this into an educational framework? But therefore we have all these documents, the ego documents, documents that are created by the perpetrated Jews themselves. And this is still something that we can incorporate into teaching, to let them speak for themselves. Let the Jewish victims tell their own stories. Let us hear their voices, their perspective. Let us see their faces if we have video interviews. Let us look at them and listen to them. And this is one last idea and also a conclusion I drew from the visit at the schools. I have visited 6 schools here in Malta, and I was very, to be honest, surprised how the students very quickly connected the history of the Shoah, of the Holocaust, to recent society, to the needs for human rights, for tolerance. And this is really, I was really impressed by that. I didn't expect so much, so many this wide perspective. But I think we should also not draw this conclusion too fast, because I felt we should remain for a moment with the Jewish victims of the Holocaust, and we should listen to individual stories, because if we discuss stories of Jewish people who had to hide, who had to escape, who were in the concentration camps, but also of the brave people who rescued them, this is where we actually fill the words of tolerance or solidarity with a real actual meaning. But we have to look into these stories, into these biographical narrations, so that it does not just become a phrase, solidarity or tolerance, but that we fill it with a real meaning that we learn from history. I think that's important.
Thank you so much. I think that's a wonderful way of approaching it. Hadar, I wonder, we've just heard about the importance of making personal these narratives and these experiences. Maybe you could talk a little bit about how does that personal relationship with these narratives become an opportunity for healing or for deeper knowledge?
Can I sing for you first?
If you would like to sing, please sing first. Yes, thank you so much.
Can I sing for you? and then I'll tell you a few things. It's an Israeli song of Hannah Senish, that probably you know. She was a Hungarian girl that came to Israel in 1939 and joined the British brigade as a parachuter, paratrooper, and was sent back to Hungary to send, she was sent back to Hungary to help her own community. Was arrested, tortured, and was shot to death. And she wrote a lot of poetry. So if I may sing for you something, and then I will explain.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for that beautiful, moving. Thank you.
Normally I don't sing in Hebrew.
But I think it perfectly connects to the question I want to ask you, which is, how does making that connection with that music, with that melody, with that poem, that prayer, how does that connect you to the narratives of these of the Holocaust?
Well, we're with.
I am an Israeli. I'm Jewish. I'm Italian. Woman, but most of all, I feel that I'm a musician. My grandparents arrived to Israel on 38, running away from their homeland, Poland. The family of my grandmother, that came from a town next to Krakow, were all gassed in Auschwitz. She was the only one to run away. And the family from my grandfather's side, he found out just on 1960s that they were shot to death in a concentration camp next to his hometown, Lvov, which today is not Poland anymore, it's Ukraine. They came to Israel, never spoke again Polish, the Polish language, never went back to Europe. It's like Europe erased them, erased their memory, their dignity, and they never wanted to come back. As a child, I was listening to classic music with my grandfather. I think he's the only one in the family that really wanted to listen with me. He loved it, he loved it. As an adult today, as a musician, as a classic musician, I think this is the only thing that he was proud of from the old continent, the old homeland, from Poland, from Europe, the only thing that he could really feel it's still his. You know, in music, as a language, it's built on harmony. But as much as it's built on harmony, it's built on, we call it dissonance. Maybe in everyday life you would call it difference or difference. But we call it as musician dissonance. And the dissonance have as much importance as the harmony, but as much as we can bring art education to learn to express ourselves as kids or in adults, I believe we can understand each other better. I guide my life to love differences. I love not that we are not the same. I think it's simultaneous. It's bring me more ideas in my life. It's much more interesting to live so. Well, I can continue.
Thank you. I think you've.
Yes.
I think.
If I may add one please. More thing, you spoke about anger. I think my grandparents were very, very angry. They came 18 years old, just leaving a note to the both families that they ran away to Israel, to the desert. And they felt all the time anger and shame. How come we left everybody? None of them were survived. But anger also, unfortunately, it's Israeli, we have to admit it. There was a few years, as maybe in Germany, nobody would really speak about it openly. In Israel, it was like they felt ashamed, the survivors and the second generation, to speak about it. For, I think, at least till 1980, it was called the Memorial Day of the Shoah. And then they changed it, Courage and Shoah, to give somehow a positive way that, yes, you can tell about it. You survive, and it's a good thing. You don't have all the time to feel ashamed. My grandparents felt ashamed, I think, till the last days.
Thank you so much. I think we can now open to interventions and questions from the floor.
I found the part where Eva Schloss talks about the 2 years she spent with her mother, not talking about the issue, but sort of respectfully staying away from it and coping. I thought that was so real and so moving, and that could translate into so many other experiences. I wondered whether for people who work with survivors, especially she talks about veterans as well from other wars, how that impacts on the way we should be mindful and treat with other people. I'm interested in your opinion about this.
We work in my teaching and in my research. I work a lot with the testimonies from the Shoah Foundation, testimonies from Yad Vashem, and also interviews with survivors and with their children. And the filmed testimonies that are available to study and to see will give you very, very meaningful and very difficult and very different perspectives of these family lives and of coping mechanisms. So there's not just one story. No? So what your grandparents did, and lady from Yad Vashem said it already, is that there are so many voices that we can listen to and that we can study. And my students find it very interesting to look at a whole testimony, a whole film testimony. And always new questions come up, and you can do a lot with testimonies. I'm at the moment making a map. I call it a talking map, a map of hiding places. There are so many locations across Europe. The Anne Frank House is not the only place where someone was in hiding. You can start with one location and say, what happened here? And then you can have all these voices around one location. The survivors, the victims, perpetrators, people who betrayed, the police, neighbors, and all this becomes dissonance, as you say. It's not a beautiful piece of music usually. It is very, very difficult music, what happened in one place. But with the testimonies, you learn about the complexity of history. And also about the complexity of memory. We sometimes want to have a sort of simple message or an easy memory. And the history and the memory of the Holocaust is really very complex. So there are important things. Of course, we say never again. There are the big messages. But we also have to realize the complexity of the history and of the memory, I think.
I have a question about that for the way Yad Vashem does its work. Obviously, the way Germany teaches the Holocaust would presumably be different from the way Malta does, the way Britain does. So how does an organization like Yad Vashem negotiate those differences along national boundaries?
First of all, we can add another perspective, the Israeli perspective. Because in Israel, for example, on the Yom HaShoah, the Holocaust Remembrance Day, there is a siren. There's a siren in public space, everything stops, cars on the street stop, buses stop, people get out of their cars, stand still and keep silent. Okay, and also very, very small children notice that. How do you explain to a three-year-old what that means? You know, so in Israel there's even the need for educators and parents as well to find an approach to discuss this issue of the Holocaust with very small kindergarten children. So this adds another twist to the story, right? In Yad Vashem, it is very important for us to have an open dialogue between Israel and, in our case, Europe. We are the European department, because as you say, Holocaust education, but also national narratives are very, very different in all the countries of Europe. In Germany, in Poland, in Malta, in Israel, there are different narratives. So when it comes to negotiations, obviously we are working with educators all over Europe, and we're trying to make programs, seminar programs for European educators that match their needs in education, that looks at their curriculum, what do they need, what can we offer. But also we want to show them our perspective, and we hope that we can learn from each other. And usually it's a very fruitful discussion that gets opened up by that.
Thank you. Maybe we can take some more questions.
Good evening. Miss Herrera, I was wondering what kind of education tools are being used at the moment, and if they are available somewhere for use. Thank you.
As I hinted at already, we believe in that personal narrations, biographical narrations are crucial, because the number 6 million is not something, you know, that you can even understand actually. So we try to work with the documents that are left behind by the Jewish victims actually and the Jewish survivors, and to put them into teaching materials. So we try to make a connection, or to make the stories of persecuted Jewish people accessible to young students, in starting at their own life today. Let's discuss with students, what do they think about identity? What kind of family history do they have? What do they want to tell about themselves? And then we can go into the story of the protagonists that we are working with. So this biographical narration is, as far as we think, crucial to raise students' interest, actually. Furthermore, we try to add several perspectives to a story to make it understand how the Shoah was a very complex story, but which was furthermore really a result of human actions and decisions. History is not a fate. History is what people do, and what we do today will also be history at some point.
I actually have two questions for you. So in the video of Eva, what struck me most, because I was very moved by the video, but one of the things that struck me most was when she said that after the war, everybody wanted harmony. Nobody wanted for war to start again, and yet 10 years after, a couple of wars started all over the world again, and it's happening again. My first question is, why do you think people start wars? What is it that drives people? What is it that makes people hate others so much? If this is such a horrible thing, why do people do it? My second question is also about the video. Eva had said that before, leadership was about what the people want, what is best for the country, what is best for the people. What do you think changed from before to now? Why do you think that leaders nowadays are all about the money and what to put in their pockets rather than justice?
Okay, thank you so much. Ambassadors, would you like to attempt an answer?
The answer, these are very difficult questions, obviously, but the answer that does come to mind to me is to the last question, because when I saw that, I was struck as well by that remark of Eva Schloss. But my thought, and I don't want to leave you less optimistic than you came in, but I think she was even, maybe her personal image of the leaders in the past might have been a bit too positive, might have been a bit too naive, if I can say so. That said, then there's the first question, maybe we leave it for you. Yes?
Okay, got the answer to the first question. And of course it's difficult, yes, we are also wondering why there are still wars. But I can only, of course, answer as a German and as a European. And for us, the answer was Europe, unified Europe. We had, and for Germany, that was really like a miracle. Already in the 50s of the last century, five countries came towards us, Italy, the Netherlands, Belgium, France, and Luxembourg, and wanted to create a European Union, which was not only an economic union, but also, of course, a union to cooperate together and to make it possible that a war would never happen again between the countries in the European Union. And this is why it is so precious for us. This is why we want to continue with it and why we want to have visions how we can keep on building up that. And indeed, in Europe, there has not been a war ever since. And when you look back to history, how many wars we have fought amongst neighbors. So yes, of course, we hope and we are doing our utmost if we can, you know, to sell this model, let's put it like this, or to convince other regions also. But of course, it's extremely difficult. So it's only a part of the answer.
I was very struck by a remark by Eva in the video where she talks about the birth of her daughter, where she says it was like for her a new hope that there is future. Also, during the school visits, the Advashem representative showed a lot of material where there was a focus on family. I remember the story of a Greek Jewish who in his presentation at the end of the video almost refers to his children and grandchildren as a miracle. And I wanted to ask about the your personal experience of this, how you felt your relatives, yes, saw family relations and if for them it was sort of a way of winning over the tragedies they went through.
I can tell you something very, very personal, since I'm not a historian and a musician. I can tell you just from my own family. I understood from my mother that to live with two people that ran away from Poland and knew that they lost all their families, it was very, very hard. If I understand, all over Israel, there are second generation that suffered a lot. So I believe in Europe the same. I have no idea how to explain it, but they grew up without love. And this is the she told that 2 years they could not speak, the mother and the kid. They could not express themselves. They could not give even love to their own kids, though they were so happy to have the family, since they did not know how to be parents, how to give love. They did not have the generation behind to give it to them or to teach them how to give. My mother did not grow up with family. She doesn't have a grandfather. I had it. So as grandkids, we had a lot of love and beautiful family. The second generation, the kids grew up not just without really a lot of love, with this feeling that you have to be good in this life, you have to be excellent in this life, you have to be much better than you, whatever you can do, because you are here and you have to say thank you because all the rest died. So we give you life, but you have to show us that you're worth it. And to grow up with this feeling, it's difficult. It's difficult to know that your parents see in you their all the other family that did not survive. This what I can tell you as a child, what I've seen, or as an adult that I understand today. Something else that I can share with you is why there are wars. I'm the last one to know the answer, but I think when somebody is aggressive in front of you, hurt you,
especially as a mother, the first emotion that you have is to fight back, to defend. If not to fight, at least to defend. And this is aggressive. So these, even in Israel, it was a long time that we felt we are very strong. We'll be a nation of soldiers. We'll show the world that nobody ever do that to the Jewish people, which is, by today, I hope it's a bit more relaxed. But the first years were like this. You have to build some kind of a defense. And when you start to defense, you start to be aggressive, unfortunately.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Pete, and our distinguished panel. Thank you for sharing and for the beautiful discussion elicited tonight. The final part of the event will be a number of short readings from Anne Frank's diary. The excerpts in English and Maltese will be read by children that are part of the Foundation Children's Councils. The Children's Councils are an integral part of the Foundation, and they play an active and important role in our work. Children present at this event also have access to a processing session after the event as a safe space where they can share, process, and discuss any thoughts, feelings, or concerns. I now would like to call Shani Lee and Willa to join me here.
Wednesday, 8 July, 1942. Dearest Khadib, it seems like years since Sunday morning. So much had happened. It's as if the whole world had suddenly turned upside down. But as you can see, Kitty, I'm still alive, and that's the main thing. Father says I'm alive all right, but don't ask where and how. You probably don't understand a word I'm saying today. So I'll begin by telling you what happened Sunday afternoon. At 3 o'clock, Hello had left but was supposed to come back later. The doorbell rang. I didn't hear it, since I was out on the balcony, lazily reading in the sun. A little while later, Margot appeared in the kitchen doorway, looking very agitated. Father has received a call-up notice from the SS. Mr. Van Dan is father's business partner and a good friend. I was stunned. A call-up, everyone knows what that means. Visions of concentration camps and lonely cells raced through my head. How could we let father go to such a fate? Of course, he's not going, declared Margot, as we waited for mother in the living room. Mother's gone to Mr. Van Dan to ask whether we can move to our hiding place tomorrow. The Van Dans are going with us. There will be 7 of us all together. Silence. We couldn't speak. The thought of father of visiting someone in the Jewish hospital and completely unaware of what was happening. The long wait for mother, the heat, the suspense, all this reduced us to silence. Suddenly, the doorbell rang. That's Hello, I said. Don't open the door, exclaimed Margot to stop me. But it wasn't necessary, since we heard Mother and Mr. Van Dan downstairs talking to Hello. And then the two of them came inside and shut the door behind them. Every time the bell rang, either Margot or I had to tiptoe downstairs to see if it was father, and we didn't let anyone else in. Margot and I were sent from the room, as Mr. Van Dan wanted to talk to mother alone. When she and I were sitting in our bedroom, Margot told me that call-up was not for father, but for her. At this second shock, I began to cry. Margot is 16, apparently. They want to send girls her age away on their own. But thank goodness she won't be going, mother had said to herself, which must be what father had meant when he talked to me about our going into hiding. Hiding, where would we hide? In the city? In the country? In a house? In a shack? When? Where? How? These were questions I wasn't allowed to ask, but they still kept running through my mind. Margot and I started packing our most important belongings into a satchel. The first thing I stuck in was this diary, and then curlers, handkerchiefs, school books, a comb, and some old letters, preoccupied by the thought of going into hiding. I stuck the craziest things in the satchel, but I'm not sorry. Memories mean more to me than dresses. Father finally came home around 5 o'clock, and we rang Mr. Clayman to ask if he could come by that evening. Mr. Van Dan left and went to get Meep. Meep arrived and promised to return later that night, taking with her a bag full of shoes, dresses, jackets, underwear, and stockings. After that, it was quiet in our flat. None of us felt like eating. It was still hot, and everything was very strange. We had rented out our big upstairs room to a Mr. Goldschmidt, a divorced man in his 30s, who apparently had nothing to do that evening, since despite all our polite hints, he hung around until 10 o'clock. Meep and Yangyi's came at 11. Meep, who's worked for father's company since 1933, has become a close friend, and so has her husband Yan. Once again, shoes, stockings, books, and underwear disappeared into Meep's bag and Yan's deep pockets. At 11:30, they too disappeared. I was exhausted, and even though I knew it had been my last night in my own bed, I fell asleep right away and didn't wake up until Mother called me at 5:30 the next morning. Fortunately, it wasn't as hot as Sunday. A warm rain fell throughout the day. The four of us were wrapped in so many layers of clothes, it looked as if we were going off to spend the night in a refrigerator. And all that just so we could take more clothes with us. No Jew in our situation would dare leave the house with a suitcase full of clothes. I was wearing two vests, three pairs of pants, a dress, and over that a skirt, a jacket, a raincoat, two pairs of stockings, heavy shoes, a cap, a scarf, and lots more. I was suffocating even before we left the house, but no one bothered to ask me how I felt. Margot stuffed her satchel with school books, went to get her bicycle, and with me leading the way, rode off into the great unknown. At any rate, that's how I thought of it, since I still didn't know where our hiding place was. At 7:30, we too closed the door behind us. Murchi, my cat, was the only living creature I said goodbye to. According to a note we left for Mr. Goldschmidt, she was to be taken to the neighbors, who would give her a good home. The stripped beds, the breakfast things on the table, the pound of meat for the cat in the kitchen, all of these created the impression that we'd left in a hurry. But we weren't interested in impressions. We just wanted to get out of there, to get away and reach our destination in safety. Nothing else mattered. More tomorrow, yours, Anne.
Aziza Kitty, issa l-allox sigrit tagħna sar sigrit tassew, peress li tant djar qed isir l-għand fiċċi għar-roti moħbija s-sur Kugler ħaseb li kien ikun aħjar jekk tinħadem librerija għal quddiem id-daħra tal-moħba tagħna. Id-dur il-barra fuq iċ-ċappetti u tinfetaħ bħal bib. Is-sur Vuskjol ħadem li njam l-sur Vuskjol kien li qalulu li aħna seba' qegħdin nistaħbew u kien tajnuna kbira. Issa kull meta rridu ninżlu isfel ikonna nitbaxxew u mbagħad naqbżu. Wara l-ewwel tliet ijiem kollha kemm aħna kellna gundalli fuq moħħna għax konna naħbtu rasna mal-fetħat baxxa tal-bieba. Imbagħad Peter għamlilha kuxin billi sammar xukuman mimli bitċana mal-gwarniċ tal-bieba. Ħanaraw jekk din tgħinx. Ma tħanx qed nagħmel xogħol tal-iskola, ħadd vankanza bidejja sa Settembru. Missieri jridni jibda jagħtini xi lezzjonijiet għal dik il-ħabta imma l-ewwel jeħtieġ nixru l-kotba kollha. Ħajjitna hawn ftit li xejn dvarja. Illum Peter ħaslu lu xaru, imma dik mhi xejn speċjali, is-sur Van Dan u jien dejjem nillatigaw, il-mamma dejjem titrattani ta' baby, ħaġa li ma niflaħilx għaliha, inkwantu qalb hija l-affarijiet sejrin aħjar. Ma naħsibx li Peter ser iżjed kustuż, tifel skifuż li jitlajja fuq is-sodda l-ġurnata kollha u jqum biss jagħmel xi ftit xogħol tal-injam u jerġa' jmur jieħu nasa x'ġidra. Dal-għodu l-mamma reġgħet għamlet li waħda mill-pritki terribbli tagħha. Għandna naħsbu l-oppost ta' xulxin f'kollox il-papa Gustus wies ġieli jirrabja miegħi imma qatt għal iżjed minn 5 minuti barra ġurnata sabiħa sħuna u pjaċevoli u minkejja kollox nippruvaw ingawdu t-temp mill-aħjar li nistgħu billi nirrilassaw fuq branda fl-attiku tiegħek Annie.
Thank you, Sebastian. Jerome Stan next.
Friday, 9th October, 1942. Dearest Kelly, today I have nothing but dismal and depressing news to report. Our many Jewish friends and acquaintances are being taken away in droves. The Gestapo is treating them very roughly and transporting them in castle trucks to Westerbork, the big camp in Drenthe, to which they're sending all the Jews. Meep told us about someone who'd managed to escape from there, but it must be terrible in Westerbork. The people get almost nothing to eat, much less to drink, as water is available only one hour a day, and there's only one lavatory and sink for several thousand people. Men and women sleep in the same room, and women and children often have their heads shaved. Escape is almost impossible. Many people look Jewish, and they're branded by their shorn heads. If it's that bad in Holland, what must it be like in those faraway and uncivilized places where the Germans are sending them? We assume that most of them are being murdered. The English radio says that they're being gassed. Perhaps that's the quickest way to die. I feel terrible. Meep's accounts of these horrors are so heartrending, and Meep is also very distraught. The other day, for instance, the Gestapo deposited an elderly, crippled Jewish woman on Meep's doorstep while they set off to find a car. The old woman was terrified of the glaring searchlights and the guns firing at the English planes overhead. Yet Meep didn't dare let her in. Nobody would. The Germans are generous enough when it comes to punishment. Beppe is also very subdued. Her boyfriend is being sent to Germany. Every time the planes fly over, she's afraid they're going to drop their entire bomb load on Bertu's head. Jokes like, "Oh, don't worry, they can't all fall on him," or "One bomb is all it takes," are hardly appropriate in this situation. Bertus is not the only one being forced to work in Germany. Trainloads of young men depart daily. Some of them try to sneak off the train when it stops at a small station, but only a few manage to escape unnoticed and find a place to hide. But that's not the end of my lamentations. Have you ever heard the term hostages? That's the latest punishment for saboteurs. It's the most horrible thing you can imagine. Leading citizens, innocent people, are taken prisoners to await their execution. If the Gestapo can't find the saboteur, they simply grab 5 hostages and line them up against the wall. You read the announcement of their death in the paper, where they're referred to as fatal accidents. Fine specimens of humanity, those Germans, and to think I'm actually one of them. No, that's not true. Hitler took away our nationality long ago. And besides, there are no greater enemies on the earth than the Germans and the Jews. Yours, Anne.
Snin flaxija, 8 ta' Novembru 1943. Wis Aziza Kitty, kieku kellek taqra li trid jgħid kollha f'daqqa waħda, kont tibqa' impressjonata bil-fatt li nkitbu varjetà sħiħa ta' burdati. Niddejjaq li niġi daqshekk affettwata mill-burdati tawn ġew fl-alloġġ, imma m'inhiex l-unika waħda, il-koll affettwati minnhom. Jekk inkun mitlufa naqra ktieb, ikolli npoġġi ħsibijieti f'daqsxejn ta' ordni qabel ma nkun nista' nitħallat man-nies, għaliex jekk le, jistgħu jaħsbuni xi stramba. Kif tista' tara, bħalissa ddejja minn depressjoni. Ma nafx ngħidlek xi kkawża, imma naħseb li ġejja mill-ġifġavni tiegħi li nħabbad f'wiċċi magħha kull il-ħin kollu. Il-lejla x'in kien għadha hawn Beppe il-ampjena tal-bit tal-bib ċemplet bil-qawwi u fit-tul. Fil-pront bjatt ħassejt taqlib fl-istonku u qalbi bdiet ħabbad sitta-sitta u dan kollu għax kont qed nibża. Bil-lejl fis-sodda nimmaġinani waħdi f'kalċi taħt l-art mingħajr missieri u ammi. Jum kella niġġerra mat-toroq jew l-alloġġ qed jaqbad jew jiġu għalina f'nost tal-għejl u jien id-disprata nitkaxkar għal taħt zotti. Nara kollox daqs li kieku kienet jiġi tassew. U min jaf jekk dan kollu hux se jiġi dal-waqt. Mib ta' spiss tgħidilna li tgħira lina għal xawn għaw tant paċi u kwiet. Dak forsi veru, imma ovvja li jien mhix tirrealizza x'biżanna fuqna. Assolutament ma nistax nimmaġina kif għalina d-dinja tista' terġa' tiġi normal. Veru li nuża l-kliem wara l-gwerra, imma ngħidhom qisni qed nitkellem dwar kastelli fl-arja, xi ħaġa li qatt ma tista' sseħħ. Nara lilna tminja tal-alloġġ qisna ruqa sema blu imdawrin u meddin fi sħab iswed. Ir-ruqa tonda perfetta li qegħdin fuqha għadha toffri sigurtà, imma sħab riesaq għal fuqna u ċ-ċirku ta' bejna u l-periklu qiegħed kull ma jdur jidjieq. Imdawrin minn swidija u perikli waqt li disprat infittxu triq tal-ħruġ, il-ħin kollu naħbtu f'xulxin. Inħarsu l-isfejn lejn il-ġliet u l-fuq lejn il-paċi u żbuħija. Sadattant il-massa skura ta' sħab iżolatna u bekk ma nistgħu morru l-isfel u lanqas il-fuq. Tidher li jiet ta' teddida quddiemna bħal ħajt impenetrabbli jipprova jaffiġna, imma li s'issa għadu ma jistax. Jien nista' biss ngħajja u nitkarrab. O ċirku, ċirku, infetaħ u ħallina noħorġu. Tiegħek Anne.